Caleb brought up this point. You know, Josh Heupel, he was a better coach this season than we've given him credit for. And I'm like, what are you talking about? I thought we've given him a lot of credit. I thought we backed him for injuries. And I thought that, you know, he's had his bad moments, but we never said he was a bad coach. Even John Adams, who usually joins us on Tuesdays, but he's traveling today. Even John Adams has said he's not worried about the state of the program, despite the fact that there were two games this season, Missouri and Florida, that were horribly coached. But three balls make the AP All-SEC team, and that is James Pierce, that is Cooper Mays, who I think kind of, he missed a lot of the season. I think this is kind of grandfathered in, but he plays at that level. There's no question. So when he was on the field, he was certainly All-SEC. And then Jaylen Wright, who I'm telling you is going to be one of those tailbacks who you want your team to have in the NFL, is power back. And I would be stunned if he came back based off what I'm hearing. I could be wrong. And then we'll see what Tennessee does if Jabari Small transfers or Jabari Small says, I want to stay. Anyway, Tennessee's running back group was a strength and could be in flux. So the Vols were seventh in representation despite finishing fifth in the league. And I thought Caleb came up with a great point. Is that a testament to Heupel's coaching? Caleb, and the reason I thought about your point throughout the morning is you have a football team here that is still just three seasons removed from a mass exodus and a complete roster turnover. I think 2022 makes us forget that a little bit. So have we, now that we have some time to sit back and think, have we undervalued the job that Josh Heupel did in 2023? Make that argument, because you made a good one at 3:45 a.m. this morning at our production meeting.
Yes, we've absolutely undervalued it. Tennessee, it's really difficult as it is, given what they're 3 years removed from. Dave, it's even more difficult when all of your key players left from the team of 2022. This is what it reminds me of. Here's actually a great analogy. Do you remember when Chris Lofton's senior year with Tyler Smith, when the Vols hit number one for the first time in Tennessee basketball? Remember that? When they beat Memphis, yes, they were number one?
Mm-hmm.
Remember the next year, they were favored to win the SEC. And people kind of got a little upset at Bruce Pearl because they actually had probably their worst year in the 6 years under him. But nobody paid attention to the fact that they had lost Chris Lofton and Jawan Smith, which was their entire backcourt from the year before. And Ramar Smith had been dismissed from the team. So, yeah, they had recruited well. They had arrived as a program, but they lost so much talent, and we had forgotten where Tennessee basketball was and the state of the program overall before we got there and how thin the depth was, that a lot of people turned on Bruce Pearl unjustifiably. Nobody was going to fire him, don't get me wrong. And then the next year, he took Tennessee to the Elite Eight, their only Elite Eight in history. I'm seeing kind of the same thing with Josh Heupel, where he took over a disaster of a program. He turns it around immediately. He turns it around with players who had a shelf life, who weren't going to be there that much longer. And they all left at the end of 2022, Jalen Hyatt, Hendon Hooker, Darnell Wright. These are transcendently talented players. So I got to be honest, I think that we're forgetting where Tennessee was and we're forgetting the job Josh Heupel did. And by the way, they weren't just seventh. They were tied for seventh with two other teams, South Carolina and I believe Mississippi State, that also had three All-SEC players. So Heupel outcoached at least four teams in the SEC to finish number five. We can't ignore that.
No, that's fair. And you didn't even mention the injuries, which would be Keenan Pilley and Cooper Mays would be two of the primary ones, Brew McCoy. Since you brought it up, let's go ahead and throw it out there. What grade would you give, and I want to hear on the message board too, Josh Heupel's coaching, considering the injuries, considering the departures? It's tough for me not to make an argument a B plus or A. Now, I think there were some in-game coaching moments that he'd like to have over. I think Florida, he would like to have over. I think Alabama, he would like to have over in some of the fourth downs. And I think Missouri came out with a defense that was completely different than anything they have done. And Josh Heupel didn't adjust at halftime or whenever the case may be. So I think there are some moments he'd like to have back, so I'm not giving him an A plus, but I wouldn't have any problem with a B plus. Rob says B plus. Derek says A all day. So I don't have a problem with a B plus, A minus, or you could probably even talk me into an A. So if that's the case, then Tennessee's in great shape moving forward, and we're going to talk about their offensive line as well, which might be better than you think. Write up on that on offthehooksports.com coming up later. But it sounds like 8-4 is a step back, and it is from 10-2. But did he do a better coaching job this year than last year? Oh, we lost your audio there, Caleb. We lost your audio. Let's bring you back there.
Rookie mistake. Rookie mistake. That's all right. I don't know if I could go better than last year, to be honest with you. I got to be honest. That's tough. Because I said in the middle of the season after the Texas A&M win that it was a better coaching job, but that Missouri loss kind of, I had to reset a little bit. Now, I will say, I actually will. This was a better coaching job than last year for Josh Heupel. Now, was it the best coaching job in the SEC? No. Dave, you hate it, but Eli Drinkwitz probably did a better coaching job this year than Josh.
I agree. No, I got no argument on that. I mean, I'll give kudos when they're due, if I don't particularly like them.
And my hot take, and people are going to call me crazy on this. Y'all can call me crazy all day. I don't care. The coach of the year in the SEC was Nick Saban. Him taking over the offense in week three with Jaylen Milroe, he should be this is the most impressive coaching job Nick Saban has ever done. He should be national coach of the year, Nick Saban, this year. And anybody that thought he was just a recruiter, look at what he did this year with Jaylen Milroe and taking over the offense. He should, I don't know if you think I'm crazy, Dave. He should be coach of the year just for that.
If you don't go into a season knowing who your quarterback is, I can't go down that road with you. I just can't. I mean, you should have a feel through spring practice and preseason camp who your quarterback is, and that decision should be made. Now, I understand that those are not always settled in the preseason, but one of a couple of things happened. He allowed Jaylen Milroe to go out there ill-prepared, or his offensive coordinator, who you pointed out yesterday, didn't have a good plan in place, and then he took over. My argument was you should have taken over before the Texas game. So I can't give him a stellar grade, but I'll give him a very good grade. I think this was one of his top two or three coaching jobs of his career. How about that? That's where I am.
That's fair. I think the mistake then would have been just the offensive coordinator hire. He just hired the wrong coordinator. But to his credit, he took over for that coordinator three weeks in, and he said, this is my offense. Nick Saban coached both sides of the ball all year. I don't think he's ever done that.
Yep. So let me ask you this. With Josh Heupel, do you feel like fans have been a little bit unfair to him because of the 8-4 record? The fact that he has been criticized frequently because of those in-game issues. Now, I don't think so. I think you and I are going to differ on this. Going forward on fourth down and your own end of the field with a lead against Alabama was beyond dumb, in my opinion. I think that Tennessee not being able to adjust, and I was told that by somebody within the program that Missouri threw a totally different defense at them. Not being able to adjust at halftime and have some sense of offensive prowess is still bizarre to me. That is probably the most surprising. But what the H brought to you by Campbell, Cunningham, Taylor, and Hahn. Enjoy life when you see better. Local vision service for LASIK, cataract surgery, and regular eye examination. CCTEyes.com, CCTEyes.com. So how many coaches in the SEC, Caleb, had a better coaching season than Josh Heupel? Obviously, you've got Nick Saban, who you believe, and I would make that argument as well. Just we're on the same page there. But who else had a better coaching season? Eli Drinkwitz? Is there anybody else? Did Josh Heupel have the third best season in the SEC?
We probably have to say Lane Kiffin too. I mean, he had to take an array of transfers because that's all he could get. And he went 10-2 and beat LSU. I mean, can we really ignore what Lane Kiffin did at Ole Miss with that? And he beat Tulane, which is not a bad non-conference win, to be honest with you. So I think we'll go Lane Kiffin. Probably had a better season than Josh Heupel. We always forget he's in the SEC, don't we? And, like, he's Lane, the biggest loudmouth.
Well, there, you know, I consider David Cutcliffe a friend, and there were times I forgot that he was at Ole Miss. Ole Miss and Mississippi State both just seem like these castaway programs, and I wonder where they're going to stand in the hierarchy of the SEC now that Texas and Oklahoma are in there as well.